Good morning, Dr. Martin Milan.
Good morning.
Good morning to the participants. Shall we start the session?
For me, it is okay. Okay, I will start my first presentation with morning. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Just trying to upload this presentation. Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay, last time I pressed something wrong, probably. Okay, once more, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to continue workshop number two, and I'm planning to have three or four presentations today. The first one is concerned with the application of a pseudostatic sliding stability analysis in a seismic design and safety evaluation of dams. It is, what shall I say, as you will see when later, it is a subject which is somehow of a continuous discussion. First, let me repeat what I have said already, and I must say a few statements I'm repeating here again, which I think is, which are quite important, and I hope that after these workshops you remember them, because some of the concepts which I have presented here are also quite new, are different from what has been done traditionally in the past. I would like to repeat here that dams were actually the first structures that were designed against earthquakes globally. It's quite interesting that dams were the first structures actually which were designed against earthquakes. Of course, there were structures designed against earthquakes in different parts of the world, like in Lisbon after an earthquake in the 18th century, in Japan and in southern Italy. But these seismic design codes were only applicable to those cities. But the dams are quite different, because here it was the first time practically all dams worldwide were designed against earthquakes. Now, the methods which were used first for concrete dams is a pseudostatic analysis method, which was developed by Westergaard in the 1930s in connection with the construction of the Hoover Dam. This method accounts for both inertial effects of the dam, that means a mass of the dam multiplied with the acceleration is an inertial force, and the hydrodynamic pressure acting on the upstream phase, which is assumed there to be a vertical phase of the dam, and the seismic hazard was represented by a seismic coefficient of typically 0.1. Because the concept of dynamic coefficient is already an old concept which has been used also for other problems like impact of vehicles on structures and so on. People have taken that into account by some coefficients. Okay, so for concrete dams, the method goes back to the 1930s, and the seismic coefficient of 0.1 has been used. At about the same time, for embankment dams, dynamic analysis was proposed by Mononobe and others in 1936. Again, the method which was proposed is a so-called pseudostatic method, where in a pseudostatic slope stability analysis, a seismic coefficient typically of 0.1 or also 0.15 were used in Japan. But basically, seismic coefficient was of 0.1 was used almost irrespective of the seismic hazard at the dam site, which in most cases was not really known at this time. So this method, this coefficient of 0.1 is still something, coefficient which people think about. I would also like to mention, for example, in Iran, in the mountains there, typically today the peak ground acceleration is maybe 0.5, 0.6 G for the four dam sites. Also there, when the dams were built, early dams, the seismic coefficient of 0.1 was used. Now, the pseudostatic method, which was proposed here by these two developers, found worldwide acceptance and is still in use today because of its, it's really very simple, because it can be done together with static analysis already. Static stress and deformation analysis and static stability analysis. And therefore, engineers, dam engineers, still want to use it also where it shall not be used. Okay, I will discuss this matter also here. There are quite a number of earthquake guidelines where this pseudostatic method is still used. And I understand that in India, in your design code, you are also using pseudostatic method. This method is also used in, still used in Japan. It is used in China. It is used in Korea and probably used in other countries, as I said, because people, engineers, really like this method because of its simplicity. So that is somehow the historical background, which goes back to the 1930s. Again, I would like to draw your attention to this fact, which you should not forget. Therefore, I'm repeating it again, that the seismic hazard is a multi-hazard. Okay, and the design, early design, which I have just mentioned from the 1930s, is focusing on the effect, basically, on ground shaking, where the ground shaking represented by an acceleration has been represented by a seismic coefficient. But the other hazards, which I pointed out already earlier, are also very important, especially mass movement, which has basically been neglected or has been treated differently from the safety, seismic safety of dams. So different concepts, safety concepts have been used by geologists for assessing the stability of embankments and for slopes. I would like to show here also some photos which I've shown before. Okay, why I'm showing these photos? I'm using the same photos again because there are simply not too many photos available internationally which shows important damage to different types of dams. So therefore, when I explain some subject, I have to refer to the same photos. You see here from a Buj earthquake and an earth dam with large cracks, more or less in the direction of the crest direction. Again, a longitudinal crack in a crest during a Butch earthquake during another, at another dam site. If you look into concrete dams, I have shown this again. This is it's a Sefidru dam in Iran. It was an important earthquake. People know relatively little about this earthquake because 1990 Iran was somehow closed, and not many people actually were able to visit that dam. But at that time, I was a member of an international reconnaissance team, which had to look in the safety of this Sefidru dam. It is one of the most important irrigation dams in Iran near the Caspian Sea. You see here just after the earthquake, I've shown you, this is a kind of a little of an overview. We have some water seeping here through some crack. We have some here, our wet spot. We have some more wet spots, and here some wet spots. And you see all these wet spots are, let me say, emerging from a horizontal crack, from horizontal cracks in different buttresses, which were cracked during that earthquake. This Manjil earthquake, I would like to mention also, the epicentral region of this earthquake was, or let me say, the epicenter of this earthquake was assumed to be only a few hundred meters from a dam site, less than 1 kilometer here from a dam foot, and it caused actually the death of about 35,000 people. It was the most destructive earthquake in the last decade of the last century. But as I said, people know relatively little. I had this, let me say, privilege to be in this reconnaissance team, so I know quite a lot, or I know quite a bit about the seismic behavior of this dam. So we have this crack. We also, this is at the upstream phase. I have shown this here also. There's a crack here. Basically, cracks, the important thing which I would like to repeat again, the cracks here basically developed along lift joints. Okay, the dam was built in blocks with heights of about 2 meters. But do you see the crack here propagates through the whole dam? The cracks, there are more severe cracking at locations. This is a structural engineering problem at this kinks, because at this kinks, sharp kinks, we have stress concentrations with also high tensile stresses, higher tensile stresses than far away. So therefore, cracks preferably develop in this kink region, as we can see here also from this Sefidru dam. So these examples I would like to use here to show that dams actually have been damaged during earthquakes, and these dams have been designed against earthquakes using the pseudostatic method. I would like to repeat here once more what I have discussed yesterday, and please remember that with general design criteria for large dams today, according to ICOLD, are as follows. For the dam safety and safety relevant or safety critical elements, that means gated spillways and low level outlets, we consider 2 levels of earthquakes. The operating basis earthquake, we discussed it yesterday, we propose 145 years. It is an economical criterion relevant for the dam owner. I would like to point that out again. The second earthquake is a safety evaluation earthquake. The ground motion parameters can be determined in a probabilistic or deterministic seismic hazard analysis. In a probabilistic analysis, we propose for high consequence terms, return period of 10,000 years, and for the deterministic analysis, we propose the maximum credible earthquake, or this is equivalent to the worst case earthquake scenario. This is a safety criterion, which is relevant for the government authority and for people living downstream of the dam. So therefore, different from the operating basis earthquake, which is an economical criterion, this is of general importance for people living downstream of dam and for the protection of the people living downstream of dam. Okay, now just two comments. We always used in design, and the government usually does not ask for the safety check of the OBE, because I said it's an economical criterion. In Switzerland, the dam safety authorities are not interested in the OBE. They are only interested in the safety evaluation earthquake because it is requested by them, and it is necessary to do some safety checks. It is necessary to do periodic safety checks, and these safety checks have only to be done for the SEE, not for the OBE. Okay, if a dam owner wants also for the OBE, he can do it, but for the government agencies who approve the dams, the focus is only on the safety evaluation earthquake. Again, to repeat from yesterday, the seismic safety and performance criteria for large dams are to retain the today. The criteria are as follows: to retain the reservoir, to control the water level in the reservoir after the earthquake. It should be possible to lower the reservoir for repair of damage if any has occurred. And secondly, to increase the safety of a dam if there are doubts about its static or seismic safety. Okay, so this require, and this I would like to recommend you in a context of seismic safety of dams, low level outlets are basically the only means for lowering the reservoir. Lowering the reservoir for some big dams, it is very, for big reservoirs, it is very difficult. In Switzerland, the general guideline is that you must be able to lower the reservoir by about one third within 8 days. This is a general guideline, and if we follow these guidelines, this gives some criteria on the capacity of the low level outlets. We cannot have low level outlets, just some small pipes of 1 meter diameter. You can never lower reservoirs. So you have some criteria that you can lower these reservoirs within a reasonable period of time. Why do we have a criterion of about lowering one third? Because for typical valley shapes, V shapes, also for some U-type shapes, if we lower the reservoir by one third, we can reduce the water load by 50%. And automatically, if we reduce the water load by 50%, the safety of the dam increases. And also in the case of failure in a top portion, the consequences of dam failure will be also reduced. So it is quite important, if you have some doubts about the safety of the dam, that you can lower this reservoir. We know, especially in some countries, in Switzerland, people have been living with that for a long time. They are not really concerned much about dam safety. But I've seen, for example, in Thailand, there are some villages living downstream of a dam, where these villagers are very much concerned about the dam safety. And if they see something minor, a small crack, they feel already that the safety of the dam is no longer there, and they called for some measures like lowering the reservoir to increase the safety of the dam. Now, from a few photos which I have shown just before, we can conclude the following. Several dams, actually many dams, have been damaged during recent earthquakes, which were designed against earthquakes using the pseudostatic analysis method. According to the safety criteria of a pseudostatic analysis, a dam should be undamaged when the static and dynamic stresses are within the allowable stresses, and when the stability safety factors against sliding and overturning are larger than one. So therefore, if these dams have been designed against earthquakes with this pseudostatic method, they should be undamaged. But as the photos I have shown, this is not the case. Therefore, we must assume that the pseudostatic method cannot be used to predict the seismic behavior of dams. Okay, this can be already the method, cannot really represent the type of damage which I have shown already in the previous photos. And therefore, there are some doubts about this method. However, as I pointed out, because of its simplicity, engineers like this pseudostatic method very much and defend it with all means, I may say like that. I had many discussions and people still come up with a pseudostatic method. Just 10 days ago, I participated, I mentioned, in the 60th anniversary symposium of the Brazilian Committee on Large Dams. And in Brazil, they feel their seismicity is very low. So therefore, most of the dams until now have not really been designed against earthquakes, or if they are designed against earthquakes, the pseudostatic method is used. But if the seismic hazard is very low, as some people claim in Brazil, if we, let me say, the seismic hazard is peak ground acceleration is less than 0.1 g, for example. Of course, if you do a pseudostatic analysis with a seismic coefficient of 0.1, then this would be okay, because the accelerations are simply not larger. It is not quite okay, but for the global stability, it would be still applicable. Otherwise, this method should actually not be used. To repeat it, it could only be used if the seismic hazard at the dam site is really very low, and I would say the value is about in the order of 0.1 g. Otherwise, it should not be used. But there is some confusion also that in some seismic codes, geotechnical codes, still a pseudostatic method is used. But this is for building structures and bridges. This is not dams. It's a difference from that. And the return periods are different. So generally, the accelerations for return periods of 475 years, which are the basis for building codes, are quite small. I think they are also quite small in some parts of India. Now, the second one, to continue with these conclusions from the photos I've shown, we know already since the 1971 San Fernando earthquake that the pseudostatic method is not a proper method for dam design, and it was not possible to predict the failure of the Lower San Fernando Dam with the pseudostatic method. So already in embankment dam design, it has been known for 50 years. Let me say, in the dam industry, that the pseudostatic method is not appropriate. But still today, as I said, it takes a long time to convince people that this method actually should be only used with very great care at some special location, and it should not be used in general. If the pseudostatic analysis method with a seismic coefficient of 0.1 was used, then the earthquake load combination was not relevant for the dam design. This is also an advantage, you know. So therefore, if you use a seismic coefficient of 0.1 and this load combination was not relevant, it did not create the biggest stresses or the critical safety factors, the shape of the dam did not have to be modified. So therefore, the cost of earthquake safety, if you use this concept, was zero. Of course, this is everybody's interested in that. Well, we know that. So please keep in mind the pseudostatic method with the seismic coefficient of 0.1 almost never required any modification in the geometry, in the shape of the dam. And therefore, it did not create any additional construction costs. Today, people say, okay, we have high acceleration. This makes the dam very much more expensive. It is always a good excuse to refer additional costs to some unusual events like increased seismicity. Today, people use the same concept and say, if they have to do a safety upgrade of the spillway, this is due to climate change. So it is a good excuse, and you can give the responsibility to somebody else. Okay. So therefore, the seismic safety was basically, with the pseudostatic method, was never a problem. Therefore, dams designed with this method have significant seismic safety reserves when modern dynamic analysis methods, seismic design and safety criteria are used. Okay, when the seismic load combination was not the relevant, was not the critical one, then of course this dam would also have, let me say, resisted higher seismic coefficient. That means when a load combination is not relevant and we increase the seismic loads, we can increase it further until it becomes relevant. So therefore, in these dams, these kind of dams have also substantial seismic reserves. Therefore, as I mentioned already earlier, if you would do a seismic safety re-evaluation of your dams using seismic hazard at the dam site according to the design criteria which I have specified previously, most of the dams would still be safe. I'm quite confident, especially well-constructed embankment dams. However, the dams which may be problematic, and this has been shown in the US and also in Switzerland relatively recently, are dams which have already some safety problems now or which show some signs of unusual behavior. So these are the kind of a candidate which will also have a seismic safety problem. So please keep that in mind. And of course, the dams which have a safety, may have a safety problems, are dams located in very highly seismic regions. Now, if we look into the stability analysis, and I would like to make here the comparison with a static analysis and dynamic analysis. If we do a pseudostatic slope stability analysis, we could get, we could remake, for example, a slope. We check a critical slope like that, apply a pseudostatic load with the seismic coefficient 0.1 times the dead load of the sliding mass as a horizontal load acting in the most unfortunate direction. That is a typical the static analysis, and we require in a static analysis that the sliding safety factors in the earthquake is larger than one. For static usual load combination, we require a safety factor of 1.5 if residual strength properties are used. If peak values or other values are used, then the cold required safety factors are higher than 1.5. 1.5 is related to residual strength properties. Now, on the seismic action, let me say if you have an earthquake occurring here and the safety factor is less than one, it will slide slightly, as shown here. But we know the earthquake is an oscillatory motion. So if you have a tenth of a second later, the acceleration acts in the opposite direction. We have an inertia force acting in this direction, and we may have a slope, critical slope like that, and we may have, if the safety factor is less than one, we will have some movement showing here. And as we have different cycles, let me say, usually strong earthquakes have maybe 10 to 20 cycles, typical cycles, we could say. So for quite strong earthquake, 10, 20 cycles, for moderate to strong, maybe 10 cycles. So therefore, if you have the acceleration here, you have again the slide here, and it gives a slow movement here, and it goes back and forth several times. And at the end, we have a deformed shape of a dam, which may look like that. This is only schematic. So what is, therefore, after the earthquake, as you can see, due to this slope movements, we can have a loss of height. The dam crest will be lowered. It is not due to compaction here. It would be an additional factor. This is only due to, let me say, movements along slopes, along the upstream and downstream faces of an embankment dam, which may result in such kind of deformed shape. Now, I would like to use this, let me say, very schematic sketch here, which was given once by Ambrasis. I think it is a very good one. If we do a static or pseudostatic analysis, usually the critical slopes are what we call deep-seated slopes. So this is a deep-seated slope, a failure surface, but actual in the seismic events, the slopes are more shallow. If we see the large number of rock slides which have occurred, most of the slides are actually surface slides, are closer to the surface. They are also closer to the surface because we have the higher accelerations near the surface and not really at the base of the dam. We have magnified motion near the crest, so typical slides would more be like that in the case of seismic events, which is different from a static one. So this shows a little the behavior of dams during earthquake and the difference in the type of analysis, pseudostatic in embankment dams, deep-seated slopes. But actually in a seismic, if you do a dynamic analysis and do a slope stability analysis, it will turn out that critical slopes are actually more shallow slopes. Now, if you look into concrete dams, this is a dam which I would also like to present today on Turkey. It's a 250 meters high. We were very involved in the design of this dam, especially in a dynamic safety check, in a seismic safety check, and we have to do some modifications here. Now, what we can see here, if you have here some ground motions, here this is for the safety evaluation earthquake, it was about 0.3 and something G. It's a base acceleration. And if we look now from a dynamic analysis, linear elastic dynamic analysis of this dam, we have an amplification. You see here to the crest is a 2.5 G, which is about 8 times larger than the peak ground acceleration at the base. And you see here the acceleration is increasing a lot towards the crest. So therefore, if we look into the stability today of concrete dams, this is the crown cantilever, we should not only check, which is standard practice, the global stability, sliding stability, where the failure is along this dam foundation contact zone here. The acceleration is actually 0.3 G. But if we see here, we have here over 2 G. So therefore, it is much more likely if we have sliding, that the sliding stability of blocks which are subjected to 8 times larger acceleration is much more likely than the sliding, the global sliding of the whole dam. So that is the difference if we do now the dynamic analysis. If we do a pseudostatic analysis, the acceleration is the same everywhere. We will not find out the problem which are in practice actually near the crest region of large concrete dams, where the stability is much more critical, as you can see here, from this acceleration than the global stability. Okay. So therefore, I must say it has been done very rarely up to now, I must say. The stability of concrete blocks in a crest region must be checked. We must have an understanding of actually the behavior of the dam during the earthquake. In the pseudostatic analysis, we will not have any amplification. The seismic coefficient is the same. It is a static one, so therefore accelerations are everywhere the same. So the crest here in a pseudostatic method will not be anything critical, which is of course not the actual situation. Similar, this is again from a dam 160 meters high in Turkey. It's a gravity dam. And again, here I have just shown a little the kind of possible failure modes, sliding failure modes of the dam. We have a global failure mode, which gives a failure along this dam foundation contact, of course, for the, let me say, for the stability analysis, a very important role is played by the distribution of the uplift pressure, because it counters the dead load of the weight and reduces here the shear resistance. Also, in this case, it's quite unfavorable that some part here is climbed towards the downstream. It would be much safer if it would be in the opposite direction. Okay, that is for global stability. But in addition, as I've said from the example of the arch dam, I have shown we may also have some critical failures at near the crest region. And we have to make some assumptions here. And here we have just looked into two critical failure modes, one which is very close to the crest and one which is a little deeper. And we have checked what is a sliding stability, and we have seen that the sliding stability of these blocks is much more critical than the global stability of the dam. Actually, we have some movements. I will show some some results then also in the context of these workshops. Now, what is basically the problem? The problem, I will also repeat it one of the next workshops, where I will discuss the seismic safety of existing dams. But here in the context of the pseudostatic method, I would like to mention that most existing dams actually, and new dams apparently are about 50 years old on average, were designed against earthquakes using methods of dynamic analysis, that means a pseudostatic method, and seismic design criteria in which the earthquake hazard was represented by a seismic coefficient at most dam sites. These methods of dynamic analysis are considered obsolete or wrong today. And I will also give another example. Therefore, the seismic safety of these dams is unknown if modern seismic design criteria are used. Therefore, and this is a call for you in India also, therefore the seismic safety of these dams must be checked to be really sure that they comply with today's safety criteria. Also, I would like to remind you, I have to say it a couple of times, the seismic safety of existing dams must be checked repeatedly during the long lifespan of dams. And I'm quite sure that your dams in India, if they are well maintained, somebody takes care of these dams, they can have a very long lifespan. The dam itself, of course, the economical life of the dam is also governed by silting up of a reservoir. If the reservoir is silted up, of course, the reservoir cannot be used as planned in the design phase. But please keep in mind, you may have to check the safety, the seismic safety, but also the flood safety, repeatedly during the long service life of dams. And you don't have to do it every year. Some people may misunderstand that. And we have seen that in the Philippines or even in Malaysia. People always ask for new seismic hazard analysis, seismic safety assessment. This is not necessary. You only have to do if there have been some important changes. And with the seismic hazard, it does not change suddenly because, like in India, you have a quite long record. So the seismic hazard does not change from one day to the other. So let me give here one example. This is a dam in New Zealand. It's about 50 meters high. And we know New Zealand is a country of high seismicity, and people are very advanced in seismic design of structures. But when this dam here, it consists of a gravity dam, and here it is another one, it's an embankment dam. So it is, you could say, this may be considered as a secondary dam or a saddle dam. The main dam here is this concrete gravity dam. And I would like to draw your attention, it was designed also in the 1950s with a pseudostatic method with a seismic coefficient of 0.1. And I would like to draw your attention here to this structure on the dam crest, which is used to lift the spillway gates. I said spillways have to be operable after the safety evaluation earthquake. So therefore, these structures here must also be designed or must be safe against the safety evaluation earthquake so that you can open the spillway gates after an earthquake. Because here this project is very dangerous, even because on this side you have an embankment dam, and if a reservoir would increase and if you would have flooding, overtopping, it would erode this embankment dam, whereas this concrete dam is much less critical, I would say, is uncritical. So therefore, it is essential that you can operate the spillway gates. And this year, this structure has been also designed, of course, for a seismic coefficient of 0.1. It is located on the dam crest. And I have mentioned already some examples that on a dam crest, the acceleration is increased, the ground acceleration is increased by a factor of 5 to 7. I've even given an example in Japan where it was 15. But typically, it would be in a range of about 5 to 7. So therefore, the seismic coefficient of 0.1, but the acceleration here is already a factor of 5 to 7 times higher. So it needs special attention. Okay, what has been the conclusion? The conclusion originally in the 1950s, the crest spillway, let me say the structure, lifting the structure for lifting the gates here, was designed by the seismic coefficient of 0.1, which represents basically, we can also call it 0.1G. However, taking into account that this is on a dam crest with amplification factors of 5 to 7, and taking into account that the seismic hazard at this site is much higher, if you use the definition of safety evaluation earthquake, much higher than 0.1G, it's probably 0.5. So therefore, for the rehabilitation, the acceleration which acts here on the support of this lifting structure is actually 1.8 G. It's 18 times larger. If you do the pseudostatic method, you see you get this very slender structure. The seismic forces are very small. There are let me say earthquake is maybe not even the relevant load combinations. But if you really take into account properly the dynamic behavior of the dam and taking into account a rational approach towards the seismic hazard at the dam site, we get here at the dam crest 1.8 G, which is almost 20 times larger. And it is clear that this structure here cannot withstand a seismic load, which is to a factor of 20 times larger than the design load. So therefore, it had to be strengthened. As you can see here, the cross-section, it looks completely different. The flanges, quite massive flanges, have been provided here at these different, we could call them shear walls, and the structure looks very different. Okay, this example I also like to use to show, let me say, the deficiencies of a pseudostatic method. This is, of course, I must say, is an extreme case in embankment dams and so on. The factors are by far not that critical, but if we use modern methods of analysis and today's safety criteria, it can be that especially structures on the crest, or for example, of concrete dams, will be subjected to very strong ground movements, ground motions, and special attention has to be paid. So we can see here, in this case, the pseudostatic method here basically gives unsafe design. It is unsafe. Therefore, I said the pseudostatic method, it is obsolete, and it can give, in cases like here, it gives completely wrong results. It gives you a wrong idea about the safety of your structure. So you have to really to be careful with this pseudostatic method. Now, the conclusion here of this discussion, I pay special attention to this pseudostatic method because there are still so many engineers who are really very keen in doing only with pseudostatic method. It may be very dangerous to use that concept. The pseudostatic method and the use of seismic coefficients to represent the earthquake ground motion, therefore, is an outdated concept and shall no longer be used for large dam projects, especially projects in areas of high seismicity. Okay, if we have hardly any seismicity, like in Sudan or in some parts of India, I think in Sri Lanka also, and in Brazil, the ground motion is very, very small. So therefore, the earthquake load case is not the relevant load case. So therefore, in such exceptional cases, the pseudostatic method could still be used, but not. But still, if a pseudostatic method would be used, we would still calculate the ground motion at the support of this structure, which should be designed pseudostatically. But we have to use then much higher coefficients. Now, as I mentioned already, the results of such analysis may be wrong. These facts have already been known since the 1971 San Fernando earthquake in California. For embankment dams, of course, if you have done structural dynamics, this is not a new science. People knew that already 100 years ago, I think, with a basic structural dynamic, or even before. But as I said, people like this pseudostatic method. Now, the characterization of a seismic hazard by a seismic coefficient is basically not based on scientific principles. It is voodoo science. How you relate, I'm reviewing quite a few papers, and I reviewed a paper from Jordania, where seismicity in the Jordan Valley is quite high. They calculated 0.7 G, deep ground accelerate 0.7 G, but the engineer, when he wanted to do the pseudostatic analysis, he said a peak ground acceleration of 0.7 G is equivalent to a seismic coefficient of 0.1. Of course, if you use that 0.1, everything is okay, as I pointed out. But this is this kind of, correlation is, of course, is prohibited. But people who defend the pseudostatic method, they use this kind of concept. Typically, people are using a factor of 1.5. This has been done in the past, that the peak ground acceleration has been divided by a factor of 1.5 in order to get the kind of coefficient. Now, for the dynamic slope stability analysis, it is also important. I have seen also in some reviews which I have done for some projects that people use for the stability analysis, they use peak strength value, they use peak friction values, they use cohesion. Okay, if you use these factors, you will get very high seismic factors. It's not the right way. In a seismic case, for slope stability analysis, you must assume residual strength properties along the sliding surfaces. And in the case you have an increased pore pressure, this must also be taken into account, because you increase pore pressure, if you use the effective stress concept and strength concept, they will reduce also the shear resistance. So under seismic stability conditions, you must consider residual strength, not peak. And you must also somehow assume or estimate the possibility of buildup of pore pressure and take that into account. Now, with pseudostatic safety factors against sliding, if you used our real accelerations, let me say site-specific seismic hazard analysis for a safety evaluation earthquake, where you have, for example, accelerations, peak accelerations of 0.6 G, and at the crest you have even some increased accelerations, maybe an increase by a factor 1.5 to 2. Therefore, if you use these accelerations within these sliding bodies, and you would do a pseudostatic stability analysis, you would get safety factors which are far below 1. And in this case, if you would use the pseudostatic method, you would have to declare many, many dams actually as unsafe. But they are not unsafe. It is just the method which is not suitable to predict or to calculate the safety of these dams using today's seismic safety criteria. So please keep in mind, now you have, I think you also have some embankment dams in the foothills of the Himalayas. And if you would do a slope stability analysis using the peak ground acceleration or the acceleration time histories at the dam site, and if you do a slope stability analysis with the peak ground acceleration, not the seismic coefficient, you have to use a peak ground acceleration, you would get safety factors which are much less than 1, and therefore your dams would have to be declared unsafe. But they are not unsafe. It is just, as I said, it is a wrong method. It cannot be used, I must say, to verify the safety of dams in areas of high seismicity. It could only work in areas of quite low seismicity. I've mentioned some of these regions also, maybe in Scandinavia and so on, and in Siberia in some parts, you have very low seismic hazard. So with that, I would like to conclude this discussion of this pseudostatic method. As I pointed out, I put quite some emphasis on that because also in India, not only in India, also in Central Europe, in Switzerland, people like this method very much, and they are not really fully aware that this method could be very dangerous if it is used, and that your dams may not really be that safe as you believe according to the pseudostatic method. The only good, let me say, statement which we can make is if the pseudostatic method was used with a seismic coefficient of 0.1, this load combination was almost never a governing load combination. So therefore, the dams designed or checked for 0.1 seismic coefficient, they have quite some seismic reserves. So therefore, as I mentioned, if you would check your dams, I would say 80-90% would have no problems, and maybe with 10-20% you would have to look in greater detail into the safety of these dams. Okay, with that, I conclude this discussion first on the pseudostatic method, and I would like to go directly to the second presentation here. And I will talk about seismic design aspects of low-level outlets, spillways, penstocks, and electromechanical equipment, because this is something new I might call it like that, because I hope you can see this this presentation, this slide. It is new because up to now, also what I've shown before, the focus on the earthquake safety has been on the dam body. But I will show that other factors shall not be underestimated, and therefore I'm discussing here these issues. These are also issues not only relevant for civil engineers, but they are very relevant to hydromechanical engineers. These are, and also to electromechanical engineers who are less familiar with seismic safety aspects than civil engineers who have been dealing with large dams for a long time. Okay, so the scope of the presentation will be as follows. I will talk about bottom outlets, or I use this term in Switzerland, we use the term bottom outlets. Somewhere else we talk about low-level outlets, irrigation outlets, flushing outlets. It is just basically low-level outlet. I will talk about spillways, I will talk something about penstocks, I will say something about hydromechanical equipment and electromechanical equipment. So if we look here, spillway, this is a photo from a Swiss dam, which shows some spillway gates here. As I pointed out, contrary to your dams in the Himalayas, where you have extremely high rainfall during monsoon region season, we do not have that. So our spillways are very small compared to spillways in Indian projects, especially in the Himalaya. Okay, but this is just an example. We talk about spillway gates, the safety of the spillway gates. We will talk here for operating the spillway gates. Of course, you have here, you see this is a hydraulic machine. There are some hydraulic piston to operate this spillway. This is basically the hydraulic motor, and they are located in a chamber below the spillway, and we have some power and control units, as we can see here. Okay, this is for the same spillway. So we saw some control units. Okay, what is critical here? Control units here. These boards should be fastened properly to a foundation, to a supporting floor, not that they overturn. As you can see here, the center of gravity is quite high of these, let me say, of this equipment here. So therefore, the overturning is an issue, and to prevent overturning, you need here proper anchoring. Here with the hydraulic system, I would also like to draw your attention. Look, you see some of the pipes. They are quite thin. They look quite vulnerable. Okay, one also has to take into account this. It would be dangerous if you would have here on top some lighting or whatever it is, or some other equipment attached, which may fall basically on this hydraulic motor, and then this would be out of operation. So you will really have to take into account that you just don't put this equipment in a place where it could be damaged by, by an infill wall, parts falling, or parts of a ceiling falling on this equipment. So that would be, this doesn't need analysis, which needs just common sense. Now, if we look into a bottom outlet, this is a bottom outlet here. These are the gates, okay, just in a control room in a dam in Switzerland. We have two gates, you see, we have two pistons for the operating gates, for the bottom outlets, we need always two gates, because we also need one reserve gate for inspection. Okay, so we must be able to lift these gates for safety reason. Now, in addition, as you can see here, we have again this hydraulic motor, which is similar to that one I've shown before, and we have some control and power units in this cabinet, as shown here. So that is typically how, in our case in Switzerland, these bottom outlets look like, or the equipment, the gates of the bottom outlet, or we just see the hydraulic pistons for operating the bottom outlets here. So that is how it could look like. It looks very clean here. In addition, I must say, these devices, they need electricity. So therefore, there is an emergency diesel generator is required in all these power plants. And it is obvious that this emergency diesel generator, they are operable after the strongest earthquake, because you must be able to open the low-level outlets and to open the spillway gates. So therefore, the emergency diesel generators, they must also be designed for the safety evaluation earthquake. Let me say, the suppliers of this equipment may not be aware of that. And this diesel generator, if it would be on a dam crest, here it is on a dam base, they put it down. If it would be near the dam crest, it would have to withstand amplified ground motions, which could be much more than 1G horizontally. In addition, we have, of course, for emergency diesel generator, they must be able to operate for some time until, let me say, these gates have been opened. There is a fuel tank, a diesel fuel tank, as you can see, of course, must also be safe, be provided. And for emergency power supply, you have also a battery room, so that you can provide emergency power supply in the case of an accident. So you must have some redundancy in a power supply to be sure that you can operate the low-level spillways, the low-level gates, and the spillways. So that is, I would say, is a typical setup, I would say, in Swiss dams. So we have spillways. It can be gated or ungated. We have the ungated are, let me say, are by far the best solution, because you do not have to be concerned about the ability to operate the gates, because there are no gates and the dam would be safe for overtopping. However, for the low-level outlets, for lowering the reservoir, which we require in our case, you need emergency power supply. So this is a typical setup which we have, and I think it is quite, I can also recommend that in India if you do not have it. Okay, we have it for our project. In addition, if we look into equipment, if we look into a switch yard, this is an example of a switch yard, a newly just under construction. What is the characteristics of the switch yard equipment? There are two characteristics. Basically, we have heavy equipment with a high center of gravity. So therefore, we may have, due to ground shaking, we may have high overturning moments. And therefore, the key issue for this equipment is, number one, to have proper anchoring. You need really good anchoring Because, yeah, this equipment here is the center of gravity is extremely high, so it can overtop very easily. But in addition, we have also to take into account that the dams usually are in hilly regions or in mountains. So therefore, the switch yards are basically have to be excavated. They are partly on excavated area because the switch yard is on a horizontal plane. Therefore, some parts of the switch yard is excavated material, is excavation, and some parts is fill. And we know if you would use a seismic code, I think also the Indian code, I'm not familiar with it, you, for the building code, you differentiate between different types of foundations. And the worst type of foundation in building codes is fill. If you have fill material, the ground motion on the rock will be amplified significantly. So therefore, if this, some of this equipment is actually on fill, it has to withstand the increased ground motion due to the fill material. So you have to be careful. Some parts which are on rock are much less critical than those located on fill. Also, the fill may settle, so you may experience some problems during earthquakes. Okay, I mentioned already that the dams were designed against earthquakes, concrete and embankment dams. So the question is, what's about the hydromechanical and the electromechanical components? We have talked about the dam body, but now I would like to draw your attention here to the hydromechanical and electromechanical components. And I've shown just before, spillway gates, low-level outlets, you need motors, you need control panels, you need emergency power supply, you need power supply, and in order that these gates function after the earthquake, of course, all this equipment must also function. So this equipment must also be able to withstand the ground motion of the safety evaluation earthquake. It is important. Most people are not really aware of that. And again, I would like to mention again here, the earthquake hazard is a multi-hazard. So therefore, equipment basically is very sensitive or very vulnerable to mass movements, to rock falls. I will just show that. So therefore, somehow also this equipment should be in a protected area and it should be well anchored to supporting floors and structural walls. Okay, this is one site we visited during the Wenchuan earthquake. You see, we have here some gates that were not so safety critical, but it is close. We see there are steep slopes in China, and you see there are some rocks here actually falling directly on these gates. Okay, so therefore, these gates are not just vulnerable to ground shaking, but we also have to look into the possibility of rock fall. And we can see, yes, the rocks are already here. They're coming to damaging these gates. Also, okay, the mass movements can be different. It can be like gravelly material, not rock boulders, but like gravel. Like here, it can block here the tail rays of the hydropower plant, as also shown here in China. We can have fault movements. This is a fault movement which occurred during the Qiqi earthquake in Taiwan in 1999. And we see here for an intake tower. Some of the fault passed through this year, which caused this spalling off of this concrete. Also in this power tunnel, we got some offset here due to a fault movement. Okay, so fault movements, not only sliding, they're not only shaking and rock falls, also fault movements can create some problems in underground structures and even on some intake structures as shown here. I mentioned already, if you cannot control the reservoir level by gates and the low level outlets, this is a run of river power plant also in China, it will be overtopped. Okay, this dam here, the concrete dam has been overtopped after the earthquake. I don't know exactly when, but usually this overtopping does not occur during the earthquake because the earthquake lasts. This was quite a strong earthquake. It lasted for about 90 seconds. This one, or 120 seconds. So the overtopping is not just during that earthquake, but it could occur days or weeks after the earthquake if you are not able to, let me say, open the spillway gates or low-level outlets or power intakes. The water level is increasing, and as it increased here, and it depends, of course, on the rate of inflow, and it depends also on the reservoir volume. But here we see if the dam is overtopped, it we see all this is about almost a year after when we were there. It was almost a year after the earthquake. We see here it is still a lot of mud here. There are some hydraulic pistons which also have been removed here. But what we can say is if you have overtopping, then basically the equipment installed on the dam crest will be, could be damaged, or it will be, let me say, it will be in muddy water. In Switzerland, if you have muddy water, if you have electrical equipment, you may have to throw it away because it will be difficult to clean it up. So it is quite critical about that, about what you have installed here on the crest. But also if you have overtopping of 2 meters, this run of river power plant is not very high. Let me say it's 20 meters. So if you have an overtopping, depending on the inflow of, let's say, 2 meters, the water load may increase by 30% or more compared to the maximum design water load. So therefore, during overtopping, because this is not taken into account in the design, the sliding stability, if the water load increases by 30% or more, the sliding stability will also be affected. So the sliding stability during this high flood could become a critical issue because also the uplift pressure will increase. So let me say the resistance will reduce quite also in connection with the increased uplift. So you would have to look into this issue as well. Here, this is a photo again from this Sefi Drew dam in Iran. This is just after the 1990 earthquake. And you see here the low level outlets or the bottom outlets are in operation. This photo is just taken after the earthquake. They are in operation. These are irrigation outlets, but we call them low-level outlets or bottom outlets also, and they are opened in order to lower the reservoir. Here we see a mid-level outlet. This is also a spillway. I would like to draw your attention here, and we have an outlet of a spillway here, which is called Morning Glory spillway. I would also like to mention, some people believe that the epicenter of this magnitude 7.5 earthquake was here, basically, right at the dam site. So it experienced really very high ground shaking and also some fault movements. Okay, now I would like to show this case. This is the dam which I've shown with open irrigation outlets. And you see here, these are the spillway intakes. These are Morning Glory spillways. And above this Morning Glory spillway, you have some platform here. But I would like to draw your attention here. During this earthquake, it is in the Alborz mountain range, quite close, about 60, 70 kilometers from the Caspian Sea, in the south of the Caspian Sea. And you see here, there are quite big boulders. These boulders here, but they were kept here on this platform above this Morning Glory spillway. And here the same, you see here some very big boulders. These boulders are almost 5 or 10 meters high. They could fall here also. They could fall here into, they didn't fall, but when they eventually, they could fall here into this Morning Glory spillway. Some smaller rocks were falling into this vertical shafts, and of course, they may create some safety problems also. So you have to take care of these rock falls, as you see, as I mentioned already, rock falls at the dam site may block or may cause a safety problems to the intakes or spillway intakes. Fortunately, here there are no gates, but if there would be some hydromechanical equipment, it probably would have been damaged by these rock falls. Now, as you can see here, this is now just above this Morning Glory spillway, which I've just shown before. You see, some of these blocks are big. They are not small. There were some revolutionary guards here, basically, who had to protect this dam. Actually, some were killed under these boulders. Some people still standing around here. So this is just after the earthquake. It was almost not possible to go to this dam site because so many people were killed during that earthquake. So, but what you can see here is some of these boulders are big boulders, and if they fall down to a spillway, they can create quite some problem. If they are big, they could even block, let me say, this ungated Morning Glory spillway. Now, I would like to say a few words about this mid-level or intermediate level spillway, which is also provided. It is basically a good idea. This is in addition to this Morning Glory spillway, which I would say is a surface spillway. This here is a mid-level spillway at a depth of about 40 meters. And here you see after the earthquake, when we were there, there was some water coming out here. Also, the water level was lowered, but it was not lowered below this intake of this intermediate level spillway. Now, this intermediate level spillway consists of a radial gate. And what it was difficult to take photos here. You see, or I got the photo finally from the Iranians, because we were not basically allowed to go in there when we were there. It was too risky. But you see here, there was some leakage. Leakage as such is not the safety problem for the dam. Okay, just shows that the seals have been damaged. Also the side seals, maybe some have been damaged already before. But for this radial gate, I would like to draw your attention of this arm here. Okay, this is this arm supporting this radial gate. Here some part had to be removed. It had to be removed because it was found that, okay, this is this arm. Here you do not see much, but you see here there is this I-beam Yes, it's iBeam, which is on the web of this arm. And you can see here, there's quite some difference, which shows that this arm has buckled. This steel part here has buckled. It is an elastoplastic buckling, which has occurred. And here we have another view. Okay, we see here some deformations. And these, let me say, high stresses in this arm were not due to hydrostatic pressures, because it was designed for hydrostatic pressures, but they were caused by hydrodynamic pressures. This mid-level outlet, the gates were close to the downstream phase. I go back here. You see these gates were here near the downstream phase, but the dam here is about maybe 60 meters thick. So there is a tunnel from the upstream phase towards here. So therefore, hydrodynamic pressure developed in this intake tunnel to this mid-level gates, and the hydrodynamic pressures caused then this overstress, caused this buckling of this arm of this radial gate. So hydrodynamic pressures, you hardly, I must say, it will be very difficult to find some examples of damage caused by hydrodynamic pressures. But there are cases like this one, I must say, is a rare case up to now, where this high hydrodynamic pressures have actually caused deformations of this arm of the dam. And as I've mentioned already, if we have inelastic deformations in a spillway gate, we may not be able to operate it. Okay, in this case, I think it was probably impossible. I don't know the details, but usually if you have inelastic deformations, then your gate may be jammed. Especially today, I must say, today manufacturing of gates, you know, is done with very high precision, and the tolerances. We have been involved in one project in at the Mekong River, Sayabur. It uses very high gates, and but the gates are fabricated with so perfectly that the tolerances were only in the range of, let me say, 5 millimeters or 1 centimeters. So therefore, if you have in modern gates very small tolerances, that allows us to have a better sealing of these gates, have a disadvantage. If you would have some small inelastic deformation or even elastic deformation, you will have some hammering or you will have some jamming of your gates. So therefore, it is still of advantage not to use too tight tolerances. From a seismic point of view, this is not really a very good idea. Also, due to other reasons, people may reduce these tolerances. In the old gates we see here in Switzerland, they have tolerances of 5-10 centimeters of very old gates of run-of-river power plants, because it was simply not able to do it very accurately. But from a sizing point of view, to have bigger tolerances is an advantage. If it is too tight, your gates may jam. Okay, so there are different interests, but one should know, one should realize that. Okay. Now, what I mentioned also again, ground shaking affects all structures of a dam project at the same time, and it also affects, that people should know, the hydromechanical equipment and the electromechanical equipment, not just the dam body. And as I've said already, for the type of design earthquakes which are used for large hydropower projects are operating basis earthquake. Of course, for gates, we would say it must be fully elastic. There should be no problem. But they also must be with safety critical gates and valves. They must also be operable after the safety evaluation earthquake. Therefore, their behavior should be more or less linear elastic or plastic deformations, which would be allowed, would be only very, very small, would be in the range of millimeters. Otherwise, we may have some problems. So this is once more, let me say, a recommendation to remind you that dam body and safety critical elements, they must be designed for the safety evaluation earthquake. If you look, for example, in a design manual of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, there are even some recommendations who say the hydromechanical equipment should only be designed for the OBE. This is not enough, because they say if it is designed for OBE with allowable stresses, it could withstand also stronger earthquake. But this is just an assumption. It really has to be checked if that is the case. And as we have seen here before, we can have in areas of high seismicity, we can have very large hydrodynamic actions, and we may also have problems with rockfalls. Okay, now, what are the seismic performance criteria of the safety relevant elements? They are the spillways, bottom outlets, valve chambers, and all associated hydromechanical and electromechanical equipment, power supply, emergency generators, and control units. So if we talk about safety relevant elements, spillway gates and bottom outlets, it is not just the structure which must be functioning. It must be the whole system must be functioning, which means the motors, power supply, and so on, and so on. This is quite important, and probably, I must say, a few hydromechanical engineers and electromechanical engineers are not really aware of that. And they have, for example, I would say the hydromechanical engineers have basically underestimated the hydrodynamic pressures acting of gates. I had in our company, ourselves, our hydromechanical engineers didn't know it, and I had to tell them how they actually have to do this kind of safety check. And now they have been doing that, and I must say it has been used elsewhere, actually, for this hydromechanical equipment. So it is a question of the mechanical engineers, hydromechanical engineers, and of electrical engineers. Electrical engineers, they must take care of their equipment as well. Okay, what are the performance level on the OBE? Of course, it's fully functional under the safety evaluation or earthquake. These elements must also be functional so that the reservoir can be operated safely and, for example, a moderate flood can be released after the earthquake. I just gave the number of 200. This is just, it's just a value which I've given, but this is a value which people shall define, but it is not, one must not be able to release after safety evaluation earthquake, the PMF, for example, probable maximum flood. It would be, that means not if you have a spillway with 20 gates, you do not ask, you have to be able to operate all 20 gates. It would be enough maybe to release a 200-year flood. That means 10 gates out of 20 would be enough. So one should be quite rational. This I have shown again. If you do this equipment, you know, also not only the civil engineers, there are not only civil structures, geotechnical, there are electrical, mechanical equipment, which have to withstand certain amounts of earthquake. I've discussed it already for the dam body. We have quite a few essential parts which are related, as I mentioned, to the low-level outlet and to the spillway gates in the case of gated spillway. Now, this is also a case of a dam in China. After the Wenchuan earthquake, the Tiping Bu concrete face rockfill dam, and there you have different intakes. This is an intake for a low-level outlet or for a low-level spillway. And they use this kind of concrete, reinforced concrete towers. And on top of these towers, you can see we have a gate room structure where you have all the equipment for lifting and operating this spillway gate, so for low-level outlet. Okay, what can we see here? During this earthquake, this structure on top of this tower shows a lot of, I always have some problem with my cursor. Okay, you see here there's a lot of damage. It's a typical damage you would experience in buildings due to strong earthquake. But here, this building is on top of a tower, and it is clear if this structure is on top of a tower, it will have to withstand an amplified ground motion. You may have an increase in the ground motion in this tower of maybe a factor 2, 3, or 4. I don't know that, but it is important that for the design of this building, you have to use the ground motion at the support. You have to use the support motion, not the motion on the rock surface, like usual. Okay, you have to use for the design of this structure, you have to use the support motion on top of this tower, which, as I said, may be a factor 2 to 4 higher than that on a rock. Here, this is the same tower, but in front of this tower, you see we have here some control board, and you see here one of this board was overturned already. So it is clear it cannot be used. So this control board was quite essential because it was used for controlling the lifting devices of these spillway gates. Okay, what does it mean? After the earthquake, also the structure looked there okay. It was not possible to operate the gates, not due to emergency power supply, but simply because this control board, one was overturning, and you see after the earthquake, quite a few people were working hard to, let me say, to repair this damage, because the problem during that earthquake was that at the time of the earthquake, the reservoir was almost empty. It was only 30% full, so therefore, the safety of the dam was not a problem. But after the earthquake, there was quite heavy rainfall. And since it was not possible to lower the reservoir, to control the reservoir level, the water level in the reservoir increased daily. And basically, it was not possible to operate this gate. And that means the dam after, this is a 156-meter high dam, is a very big dam. it could have threatened even millions of people, or more than a million people living downstream. So the dam became unsafe days after the earthquake, but it did not become unsafe because the dam was unsafe, because of this unit here, or because of this control board which was overturned. What can we learn here? Okay, finally they managed to repair it and to control the reservoir. But if you are not able to repair that, you could you could not do anything, basically, or it would be difficult to do anything. Okay, what is the lesson learned? The supplier of this electrical equipment, of course, they have no idea what is the functioning, or let me say, where it will be installed and what would be a seismic hazard. Seismic safety is also not their core business. So therefore, the whole problem could have been eliminated by properly anchoring these control boards to the floor and to a structural wall. It has not been done. Okay, we should not fix it to infill walls. This look like infill walls due to this crack here. It should be connected to structural walls which are stable. But what I want to show here, it is even very small items like that could have a large effect on the safety of the dam. This was 2008, and this is 3 years before this nuclear incident during the 2011 earthquake in Japan, Fukushima, you know, where also it was not possible to operate emergency power supply due to effect of tsunami in this power plant. So it is something similar, that people have not really taken care of some of the, hazards. Okay, just to show some gates. Here is the run of rivers power plant. We have here again a radial gate. With the arm, we can see here better than the one I've shown in Iran, which has buckled in this region. Okay, we have here some hydraulic piston. This is one of the spillway gates there, but some of the spillway gates we could see, the one close to the right abutment. You see here this hydraulic piston is just hanging like that. Here, why another one, another view on the opposite side, it looks also like that. It shows that basically there is no more gate. On the adjacent openings, you can see there are still gates here opened. But here, we do not see the gates. The pistons are like that. What has happened here? It is on the arm of this radial gate, which is here anchored on this trunnion. What has happened is a stone was basically falling on this arm. And this arm, of course, is only designed for normal forces, not for shear forces. So there, okay, you can see here, this arm has to resist the hydrostatic pressure. So therefore, we have basically axial loads here in this arm. But now, when due to rock fall, if maybe a stone of a few hundred kilos is falling on this arm, it creates a force here in this direction. And therefore, you see here, this is now this anchor block. It fell down from these anchors because there is no shear resistance provided. And when the whole gate was washed away, and people say they didn't find the gate. Okay, anyway, that was just what some people said. Okay, what I want to say is that also the loads can be determined very accurately, the water loads on this radial gate. If we are here, like in this case, close to the abutment, where some rock falls are possible, there are loads loads possible acting in different directions than was considered in the design. And therefore, we have this kind of failure mode. Okay, this is a steel gate for a power intake. It's the same project. And you can see here, there are some indentation. I just go quickly through them. Okay, this tower, again, I would say seismically, it is not very favorable. It is, as you can see, it is a frame structure here. On top, you have the equipment for lifting, operating this steel gate. You have here a relatively high mass. And if you have here some ground shaking, the seismic safety of this frame could be problematic. This is in addition. We have not seen much, we have not seen the damage there, but we have seen the damage at this gate. And you can see this tower, this gate structure here is located very close to a steep abutment at this run of river power plant. But as you can see, this rock, if we zoom in here, you see this steel plate has actually been punctured. It failed in. So the rock fall here can have, okay, it depends on the type of rocks, but these rocks falling from great height, they can have quite some effect, and it could, of course, also damage the structure of the building on top of this frame structure. Okay, what I want to say, even some rock falls may penetrate a steel plate with a thickness of maybe 10 to 12 millimeters. I don't know exactly how thick it was. Okay, now let's say something about penstocks, penstock failure and flooding of powerhouse. You see here there is a dam, and I'm not showing it, about 4 kilometers away, and the power tunnel leads to the powerhouse. The powerhouse is here, and there is a penstock leading to this powerhouse. Sorry, but it just... And you see here, there is just water coming out here. It's like a big fountain. And you see here is already some flooding here on this dam site. Okay, what has happened? You see a picture. This is after the earthquake, just after the earthquake. You have a big fountain here, water splashing out. Some more water splashing out. We have here... I still have some problem. Okay, here it comes. Here is a powerhouse, and we have some buildings here, the premises of this powerhouse, and we see here is a steep slope. We have a steep slope, and we have some rock falls here, rock falls damaging some office buildings here. Okay, and we see here, due to this water being released, we have here flooding occurring at this dam site. Okay, again, our house here. There are some damage you can see on the roof. The roof has been damaged, I will show it, due to rock falling, some rocks falling and penetrating the powerhouse roof. And we see have here a switchyard, which is inundated by the failure of this penstock here. Now, how did it look after the earthquake? The failure of the penstock basically occurred at an expansion joint. You see here, the water, it is not that the pipe burst, it just was released under high pressure at this expansion joint, which was damaged due to, let me say, small differential movements, most likely, in transverse direction. This is when we visited that place about a year later. You see, this is now the repaired expansion joint. It goes here on the left to the powerhouse. On the right, this penstock is embedded in a concrete. And this penstock, as you see here, which is the expansion joint, it is in concrete because it's crossing here a river. It is basically a penstock bridge together with reinforced basically by the pipe is this bridge, and here it comes out of the mountain. Now, just to show briefly what happened here during that earthquake, this is a photo of a powerhouse before the earthquake. It looks quite nice. But you see here, this is a powerhouse after the earthquake and after a flooding. Because basically, through the penstock failure, the whole reservoir of the dam, which was about 3 kilometers away, was released. And it caused this flooding. And you see here some sediments was deposited in this switchyard. Okay, again, this some sediments here. This is a switchyard. This picture that I've taken is almost a year after the earthquake. And we see here there are these rock walls, which I've shown also coming down, damaging here some parts, and also damaging then the powerhouse. The slope here is quite steep and very high. You can see here some rockfall damaging some office building here. Okay, this is inside the powerhouse. It is a relatively small one. It looks standard, like new. But during this penstock failure, the powerhouse was also flooded. You see here, powerhouse is underwater. It's just when this penstock water was released, this powerhouse here was flooded. And after the water disappeared, let me say, or the reservoir was empty, one could visit the powerhouse also. And you could see a photo I have shown a couple of times. We have here the wall facing the slope, the steep, let me say, slope, where rocks penetrated the infoil wall. As I mentioned already, it looks like somebody shoot with artillery on this wall. In addition, you can see here on the roof of this powerhouse, there were stones which were destroying this roof at different locations. And there was this gantry crane here. You see here, the crane was here. It was hit by a stone, and you see it also fall down. Also from a flooding, which occurred to a penstock failure, you have a lot of dirt and sediment deposited within the powerhouse, control units all dirty, and so on. This was just after the earthquake. But when I was there with the group, this crane was already, a new crane was placed here, but the damage in the fall, in the wall was still, of course, the same. And we see here some debris from the old crane. We also see some of the stones which were falling from the mountains through the roof. Okay, this is a close-up. You see some of these stones are quite big. Of course, when they could penetrate this wall, that they could penetrate, puncture the roof of a building. Some other photos here of this debris from this rock wall and from the gantry crane here, which of course was heavily damaged. Okay, another picture here of a powerhouse site. Again, powerhouse to the left, an office building damaged mainly due to rock fall. Again, this is a tail race. Then it's also a lot of sediments. Now let me come also with this project. There was also some water supply, some aqueduct was provided, and here this aqueduct, this is a bridge. What we can see here, it is made of simply supported beams located on quite slender columns. Of course, these columns, as you can see, is rock falls everywhere. During that earthquake, it was estimated maybe over 100,000 rock falls. You cannot count them, but just some local rock falls are enough here to damage here the support here, but slender columns are quite critical if the support area is not big enough. You can see here there was some more rock falls. There were some columns which moved, so the bridge, which are simply supported, let me say bridge element, way for office aqueduct, which fell off of this support. So several fell down, and the piers here are very flexible, not suitable to withstand these rock falls. Okay, rock falls are also a problem for tunnels. Tunnels in general, they are quite resisting to earthquake, but what the critical parts in tunnels are basically portal regions. As you can see here, we have a steep slope, and this is the diversion tunnel. It was not used anymore. Okay, we see here a power plant. It's a diversion tunnel. It's not used anymore, but it shows the problem with tunnels. Vulnerable are portals. In tunnels, vulnerable are also parts where during construction the contractor has faced technical problems or safety problems. These will also be locations where you may have seismic problems. You see here is also intake to an underground power plant. It is a lot of rock slides. This is also a month, a year later, where people have cleared already the access. Again, this is from Taiwan. This is also a blocked tunnel to a tunnel portal by rock slides. So I would say portals could be susceptible to rock slides. Now, let me say just a few words, we are close to the end, about amplification of support shaking of equipment on dam crest. This is a project in Mozambique where we are planning in Zambezi River, where they are planning to have a gravity dam with gated spillway on top of the dam. As you can see here, this is just a sketch here. The dam has not yet been built. But it is clear if you have, let me say, gated spillways on the dam crest, here is gated spillways, they will experience increased accelerations. The acceleration is transferred here at the support. So for equipment, what is relevant is the ground motion or is the acceleration at the support of the equipment. And I mentioned already a couple of times, for gravity dams, we may have amplification factors of 5, 6, 7, maybe here we have amplifications of 4, 5. Usually there in, this is a rift valley, the accelerations are not so high, but due to the amplification, I think the safety evaluation earthquake was about 0.3 G. Some people thought it's much too high already for that place, but that is just the feeling of some people. But for the support here, maybe the acceleration may be 1.5 G. And therefore, then the safety of these gates may become a problem. Okay. So the central crest spillways need special attention because you cannot use the pseudostatic analysis. This is an example from Malaysia. It's an old, relatively old dam, but it shows you for spillway gates, okay, it comes here. For the spillway gates to operate the gates, there are some counterweights. The counterweights are protruding quite a bit. Okay, Malaysia is not an area of high seismicity, but I just want to show it what is a vulnerable issue. This arm here, where the counterweight is supported, is basically designed for vertical load. But it is clear that during the earthquake, we have strong components also in a cross valley direction. Now, in this case here, let me say the stiffness in a transverse direction is almost zero. So therefore, if you would have an earthquake, all these counterweights basically would fall down and it will not be possible to operate with gates. Okay, this is the kind of construction which has been used in some older gates. I just wanted to show what kind of problems people may experience. So therefore, even in this case, also the seismic safety is small. The seismic hazard is small. These spillway gates may be vulnerable to small earthquakes. And this gate I have already shown, which needed substantial strengthening as it was designed with a pseudostatic approach. I would also like to mention, sorry, I still have about 5 minutes, that in power plants, you also have several buildings. Also, these buildings are not designed against earthquakes using the same safety criteria as a dam body. So the damage will be much more severe during strong earthquakes to these buildings than to the dam body. You see here, this is a photo also from Iran, from a control center of a power plant. And you see here a control board. There was some infill wall. You see here, it's usually just separating, it's just completely damaged, but there are also some parts falling from the ceiling on the control board. And if a control board is used for operating something important, here is power production. But if it would be in a gate room, if it would fall on a control board, you would also not be able to operate due to, let me say, damage of architectural features, which are not designed, nobody designing really for earthquake. It's better not to have that. This dam was also attacked repeatedly by the Iraqi Air Force during the Iraq-Iranian War in 1980s. Therefore, they had here this still with sandbags when we were there. Okay, I mentioned already switchyards. Switchyards are partly on fill, so therefore the fill will be susceptible to increased ground motion, and it may also experience ground movements, and it may also experience, like in this case, some stability, sliding stability problem like here in Iran. So therefore, switchyard, you have to be sure about the support of your equipment. If it is not anchored properly, you see you have this overturning of this equipment with the high center, which is characterized by a high center of mass. Again, some insulators falling down. We have also transformers. Usually they are on rail. They are rail. They should be secured. It was derailed here. Okay, some other one also derailed. Transmission power, they are vulnerable, as we can see here, to rockfall. A small boulder, well, maybe 1-2 cubic meter is destroying this transmission tower, and it is clear once a transmission tower fails, the power supply will break down and the power plants will stop generating energy. It would be quite simple to protect that. We have a lot of them in Switzerland. We have many avalanches. We would just provide here a V-shape protection here. Here, nothing has been done. But the solutions are simple. This is from a Wenchuan earthquake. You see here some damage. One of the legs has been damaged by rockfall. It is rockfall is really an issue for these transmission towers. Maybe you cannot see it very well, but this is another tower here in China, which failed also due to rockfall. So we have many transmission towers which failed here in the epicentral region because there are, as I said, really huge number of rockfalls. So therefore, you have to assume that in this region, all power plants will be out of operation in the case of such an earthquake, as the energy transmission system will fail. This is for sure. We see here some damage of the powerhouse. You can see here some penstock here. Okay, so structural damage here. It is not directly here due to rockfalls. It is more due to ground shaking. An important issue is access. If a structure has been damaged, it must be possible to make a repair quickly, and that requires also access to the plant. And we see here, this is the access road to one of the power plants, actually to the dam where we have, where the penstock has failed, which I've shown. And you see there have been so many rockfalls that people had to do hiking to the dam site, or they had to use helicopters to the dam site, and it was impossible to do repair because it is impossible to bring heavy equipment to the dam site, which may have been necessary. You see the whole, basically the whole access road, about 3-4 kilometers, which is some parts were also in the tunnel. They were blocked, and that was also a reason why we were not able to visit this dam site for almost a year. Only it took finally about a year to clear the access road again to the dam. So for dam safety, access to the project is important. So the conclusion of this discussion of this, let me say, non-dam structure, safety critical structures, what we have to take into account is the earthquake hazard is a multi-hazard, and the rockfall hazard has been underestimated in most places. We can see that in China. Otherwise, they would not have placed these powerhouses and so on so close to dangerous slopes. Number two, hydromechanical and electromechanical components must be designed against earthquakes and existing facilities of existing dams actually be checked. And the last items, spillways and low-level outlets used for controlling reservoir level must function after a safety evaluation earthquake, and therefore must be designed for the safety evaluation earthquake. I hope that this presentation also has given some ideas to electromechanical, hydromechanical, and electrical engineers to show them the importance of some of their equipment, especially those needed in connection with spillway gates and low-level outlets. So I have taken a little more time. Thank you very much. And I think we have some time for some questions.
Do we have the questions from the participants?
Okay, I thought it was quite clear based on this.
Yes, I guess.
On these photos, it is important to see the type of problems which are possible, because usually the engineers look only into their standard problems like the dam body, and the electrical and hydromechanical engineers are not really aware safety, often of seismic safety of their equipment. So if there are any questions, everything was very clear. So I also think, okay, in India you have quite a few dams. So if you check the safety of the dams, you would also have to check with spillway gates and low-level outlets and the whole systems. And you would also have to check about rockfalls, for example. So I think if there are no questions, I think we can close this first session, where I've taken already more time. And
sure, sir. Looking forward to meet all at the 1500 hours IST for the second session.
Yes. Okay, thank you. Can also ask a question afterwards, yes. Okay, so have a good lunch. Yes.